Simon & Schuster Audio presents Blood of the Lamb, A Novel of Secrets by Sam Cabot. Read by Jason Culp.
Prologue. April 21st, 1992. He wasn't prepared. He never could have been. As the fire rose in him, he understood that. They discussed it, so deeply and so long. The right thing or wrong? She'd cautioned, counseled patience. But he knew what he wanted. Knew with a certainty rock solid, and also rolling, cresting, an endless ocean wave. She wanted the same, he knew that. Her restraint, an attempt to protect him from irreparable error, if error it were. It wasn't, he was sure. The reverse, it was the choice that could join them together, give each to the other in ways beyond even the love and the bond they already shared. They decided, and once weather was behind them, when and where became simple. Now, this soft spring dusk, the sky fading from violet to onyx, as it had the night she'd first revealed to him that this was possible. Here, in the parlor of her ancient home, a tower that had stood centuries upon this spot and watched Rome grow around it, watched the world change. In the dark and silent room, she lit no lamps, put on no music. The street lights' distant gleam, footsteps in the piazza below. "It's enough," she whispered. They'd had wine, velvety Barbaresco, but now the wine glasses stood forgotten. On a cloth of cobalt silk spread across an intricate carpet, she leaned over him, the pale streaks in her long black hair glittering in the dim light. Silver to his gold, as her green eyes were ocean to his sky. She paused for a moment, but she didn't ask if he was sure. The time for that had passed. She brushed his lips once with hers. He was seized suddenly with a yearning to wrap his arms tight around her, to press her body against his, but he didn't move. He couldn't move. She took his hand. She kissed his palm, and a moan escaped him. She moved her lips slowly to his wrist. Another kiss, another moan. Then a fierce, sharp pain, a searing that flashed to shoulder and fingertips. It faded as fast as it had come, to nothing, to numbness. Time passed. He didn't know how much. And now this. Everywhere, every cell, he swore he could feel them each individually, in every one, a warmth, a generous, suffusing heat began, intensified, rose. The sense of it made him joyous, wild. As it heightened, he was sure he was ablaze, would be consumed by fire from within, and he couldn't stop himself. He laughed. Slowly, the burning faded too. He turned amazed eyes to her. She was smiling. Her breath, her blood, her gardenia scent, he knew them all. His blood knew them all, as it knew, as he knew, the cat out on the cobblestones, licking its paw. The soft murmur of lovers crossing the piazza, hand in hand. Intoxicating perfume drifted in the open window. The blossoms on the magnolias, too faint for him before. Somewhere, not close, someone played a piano. He heard the instrument, and he heard the distance. He had changed. Chapter 1. May 27th, 1849. Dear Margaret, I write to you tonight on a matter of utmost consequence. Please, my friend, give your gravest consideration to what I am about to ask of you. I am guilty, I know, of a fondness for the grand gesture, and I imagine you are rolling your eyes at yet more melodrama from your little poet. but I am in earnest when I say that what is contained herein, as fantastic as you may find it, is simply and momentously the truth. With this letter I send you a small sealed box. It holds a copy I made of a document obtained from the library of the Vatican itself. Obtained? Margaret, I stole it. As you no doubt know by now, Pius IX has fled, taking refuge from our righteous cause in the kingdom of the Two Sicilies. Here in Rome, his craven disappearance has been rumored for months. Thus the Pope defends his faith? Ha! But we were not assured of it until this Easter last. As the news spread, our soldiers were hard put to choose between festivity and fury. The coward Pope has summoned the French. The French! And crawled away. In the end, being unable to dissuade my men from their consuming rage, I chose to channel it. I led them to the very gates of the Vatican, barely more than a howling mob. Barely, but yet more, soldiers still, and under my command. Since receiving my commission from General Garibaldi, your fat and laughing poet has become a very good officer, indeed I have. They would have eagerly stormed the walls at any spot, but I conducted them to the gate nearest the library, though the purposeful nature of my orders was perhaps not apparent. Wait, I hear your voice, and you are shocked. Wild soldiers, marauding through that storehouse of wisdom? Papal possessions or not, the glories contained therein are world treasures. You, Mario, deliberately led soldiers thence? Margaret, your reverence for learning causes horror to ring loud, drowning out the bravo you are no doubt otherwise heaping upon me for my martial prowess. Withhold your judgment, I beg of you. I was in search of the very document, a copy of which I send you now, and under cover of my soldiers' rampages, I found it. Immediately, I ordered them out, and they obeyed. Yes, there was damage, and there was pilfering. These were unavoidable, my intent being to create a chaos in which my retrieval of these papers would go unnoticed. This document, dear friend, will shatter the church. I retain the original, and believe me when I tell you, I have taken steps to conceal it well, in a place that will resist flames, floods, and the predations of the French. I fully intend and expect to employ it myself, at a moment of my choosing, to maximum effect. But Louis Napoleon's army, led by that jellyfish Charles Oudinot, remains camped outside the city. We were told they were impartial, come to mediate between Pius IX and his subjects. His subjects, my God. But Oudinot has thrown his lot in with the papacy. I cannot say this surprised me. His master is that Napoleon, elected president by free vote of his people, who is rumored on the verge of declaring himself their emperor. Emperor, Margaret. Does he intend to be Caligula, or perhaps to rule Cathay? This is why I write to you now. It is likely but a matter of time before Oudinot takes action on behalf of Pius IX and lays siege. If he does, he will succeed. It is that simple. Our army will be defeated, but we will not. This document, Margaret, will be the salvation of the Republican cause. Of more than that, it will throw the papal boot from the neck of the Italian people, of my people, and be the agent of its fall from the necks of those who love freedom in every corner of the world. But know this. Once the inner cabal of the church understands that it is gone, they will stop at nothing to get it back. Thus your friend, full of buoyant confidence though I am, might at some point be no more. Improbable, Margaret, so do not fear. I am a hard man to kill. More credible is the prospect that, despite all my planning, the document itself will be destroyed, or that I will be prevented from recovering it to make the use of it that I so ardently wish. and so wholly intend. Why not then just say where the document is instead of this overwrought business of copies, locked boxes, and other absurdly theatrical goings-on, you ask? And though I shall not tell you where it is, I will say how very much I am enjoying this imaginary conversation.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.